I get to be the pastor here at Church in the Wild, and I don't know about you, but today it is snowing and I am ecstatic. Like, I am so happy. I know some of you are mad. I prayed for this. It's an answer to prayer. I love snow. I'm so thrilled that it's snowing right now. I was on the parking lot doing snow angels during the worship. So, man, I'm so happy to be able to worship with you today. If you have a Bible, turn to Psalm chapter 92. Psalm chapter 92, if you have a Bible. Psalm chapter 92 says this: "It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord, and to sing praises unto your name, O Most High, to show forth your loving kindness in the morning, and your faithfulness every night. Upon an instrument of 10 strings, and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. For thou, Lord, hast made me glad through thy work. I will triumph in the work of thy hands. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. A brutish man knows not this, neither does a fool understand this. When the wicked spring as the grass, and when all the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. But thou, O Lord, art most high forevermore." Can you do me a favor? Can you pray with me? We got something going on right now that needs to be taken care of. So can you just pray with me for this thing that's happening and for the people who are involved? Lord, Heavenly Father, you are gracious, kind. You're loving, you're just. You are our God. You're a good, good Father. How good are you? You are so good to us. We do not deserve your grace, your mercy, your healing, your power, your love, and your strength. Yet every day you bestow blessing after blessing after blessing after blessing upon us. You work miracles in and around us daily. God, I pray for those who need your presence right now, that you would be that presence for them, Lord. I pray for those right now who need your hand, that you would provide your hand, Lord. I pray for those right now who are going through something, that you would be there for them, Lord. I pray for those who are suffering right now, that you would be present. I pray for those who are hurting right now, that you would comfort. I pray for those who are sick right now, that you would heal. Lord, we speak your name against those, the anxiety, the fear that binds us and grips us, the bitterness and the hatred and the anger that sometimes holds on to us and grabs us. Lord, we speak against that in the name of Jesus. We talk right now, Lord, about how good you are. And we are reminded, Lord, every week of how good you are during the worship. But Lord, I pray that we would see and sense and feel your goodness and your presence and your power all the time. That it would be a continual thing, that we don't just go to church to have you show up, but that when we show up, you show up with us. Because you are God and you are with us. You are within us and working through us. So God, I pray that you would do so again right now. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, so this is my fifth time speaking in less than 48 hours. So I got this figured out, right? Man, I'm just thankful for coffee, first of all, right? Coffee is so good. But man, I've been able to speak to teenagers 4 times this week, and it was awesome. It was fun to be a part of it. But I'm so glad to be able to speak to you. I'm thrilled to be here and to be able to just speak this message that God's been giving you, me. So most of the time, I write my sermons well in advance. But this sermon, Happy Thanksgiving, that I wrote recently, I was texting Josh and Chuck about this. I said, so Happy Thanksgiving was supposed to be one sermon that is now 3 sermons. And if I'm honest, it probably should be 6 sermons. And I could probably really stretch it into 12. Because the more I read about gratitude, the more I'm just overwhelmed by the goodness of God in our lives every day. Do you have a smartphone? Does everybody in here have a smartphone? You don't have to hold it up. I think most of us do. I don't know if anybody in here. Okay, we'll ask this question. Is there anybody in here rocking the old flip phone, like the Motorola Razr? Okay, we got one. Okay, nice. I love it. I love it. The Motorola Razr was so cool back when I was in college. That was like the cool phone. Everyone would be like, man, it's so slim. It can fit right in your pocket, until they sat on it and it shattered in half every time. Smartphones are awesome, but the problem I have with smartphones is they keep getting smarter, but I don't. Right? Like, they don't make me any smarter. The phone just gets smarter. So these phones do all of these new things that I don't even understand. Like, I just barely have figured out how to email. And now they're doing all these other things. Like, I'm an old soul. I'm an old soul. So some of this stuff, I'm like, what are we talking about? I bought a smartphone, the very first one. It took me months to figure out how to email with that thing. Like, months. And then, like, a year into it, my wife was like, hey, by the way, Facebook can be on your phone. You don't have to use dial-up to get Facebook. I'm like, what? Really? She's like, you have an iPhone at work. I'm like, oh. And now, like, phones, you know, they measure my calories. They measure my steps. I have a heart monitor that I wear because I have a heart condition. And so I wear this heart monitor, and it tells me, like, hey, stop. Your heart's beating too fast. Stop what you're doing. My phone starts flashing at me. They do more and more. There's more and more upgrades, right? Reminds me of cars. I used to have an old 1994 F-250. It was jacked way up, big old tires on it. And the way that I would change the lights from bright to dim was there was this silver knob on the floor by the brake pedal. And I would step on it like that. And it would change the lights. And if someone was a real jerk, you just stepped on it twice and it boom, like it really lit their face up. Now, I mean, my wife has this Ford Explorer. This thing does things that I don't even understand. Like, it tries to back up for me. I'm like, no, thank you. I will back up for myself. It tells me, like, hey, don't forget you have a child in the back of your car when I get out. I'm like, what? I do? And then Sam's like, no, she's not in here. Oh, okay. I mean, it does all these different things. I'm driving down the road in this thing, and I'm trying to figure out this car, and the lights keep getting bright and dim and bright and dim, so I keep switching them back the way I want them, and finally my wife's like, stop doing that. It's telling you the appropriate level of brightness that you need based off its surroundings. You're going to break my new vehicle. I think gratitude is a little bit like this. At first, it seems like gratitude does one thing for us. So, like, last week we learned that gratitude gives us joy and fights anxiety, and along the way it makes us healthy. And we talked about this, and after the sermon, I was talking to a doctor, and he was talking about this with me, and he said, you know, what you just said was so true. He did a lengthy study on it, and he said, literally every organ in your body, it is proven that it gets healthier as you become more grateful. And that's why they're trying to figure out a lot of those hospitals are trying to figure out ways to bring in ways to encourage people and make them grateful, because it helps them heal faster after surgeries. If someone has a surgery and they have reasons to be thankful, their body literally heals faster. But the more I read about gratitude, the more I said, forget the preaching schedule, I'm going to preach what God's wanting me to preach right now, because I realized it has so many more upgrades to it. It's like you got a basic phone and you're thankful for it, and all of a sudden you got the brand new phone that's doing everything, or a car that's doing all of these brand new updates for you. Because the more I study and read about gratitude, the more I realize just how amazing and powerful gratitude is. Think about this story. Look at Luke chapter 17, verse 11. This is one of the just coolest stories in the Bible. Luke 17, verse 11. It came to pass as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. As he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. So for those who don't know, leprosy was a disease. It's still around, but here in America, we figured out ways to stop it. And what it does is it begins to eat at your skin. And back in the day, they did not have any way of controlling it. So if you were a leper, they just kicked you out of society. It's where we get our phrase, wouldn't touch that with a 10-foot pole. Because literally, in the old towns, they had people with 10-foot poles pushing lepers out of the town. That's where we get the saying. They stood afar off and they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. When he saw them, he said to them, go show yourself to the priests. It came to pass as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, When he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God. Look at what he did. He fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. These are the enemies of the Jewish people at this time. Jesus answering said, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God save this stranger." And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Thy faith has made you whole." What an incredible story. Someone who is supposed to be the enemy of Christ, someone who traditionally and culturally has been at odds with the people that Jesus comes from. They have been at odds with him. They have been fighting with them. They see Jesus afar off. They recognize that he's God. And he says, "Hey, just obey me. Go to the priest. And if you have faith to obey me and begin your process, you will be healed." And 9 of them say, "Okay, thank you, we're going to continue on our way." But one of them turns around, falls on his face, and gives thanks to Jesus. Now, the Bible doesn't say why the other 9 didn't return. We don't know why. We have no idea why the other 9 did not return. But we do know that one of them said, "I am so healed, I can't help but say thank you to him." He shouts praise, falling on his feet. And then Jesus says to him, "Your faith has made you whole." This is the only one that he says this to. He doesn't say this to the rest of them. What he's saying is your gratitude just gave you an upgrade. And a lot of people believe that this passage means that because he fell down at the feet of Jesus and said thank you, that literally he became a child of God in that moment. So what does gratitude do for us besides just make us happy? Well, it draws us near to God. This leper is the only one who gets to sit at the feet of the Creator. He worships, and his prayer of thankfulness reveals his heart, and it reveals the heart of God, and it draws us to him, and we get to be close to the Creator when we are grateful. It draws us to him. Like a magnet, our gratitude to God pulls us closer to him. This is so important because what all of us Christians will have happen at some point in our Christian life is we will say, "I feel distant from God." And usually what follows is, "And here's what I'm unhappy about, and here's what I don't like, and here's where I'm not happy with this or this or this or this." But if we feel distant from God, the answer is to be grateful for what he has done and is doing in our life. Number 2, it brings us contentment. It brings us contentment. 1 Timothy 6, 6 or 8 says this, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." I love how it finishes this in verse 7. "We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. Having food and raiment, let us therewith be content." See, here in America, we think this. Well, if I'm content, I'll be grateful. So here's what we say. I hear it all the time. Well, if I'm married, I'll stop complaining because I just want to get married and I'll be happy. What happens when we get married? Well, if we just had a house, I would stop complaining. We get an apartment, we get a house. Well, if I just had a nicer house, I'd stop complaining. We get the nicer house. Well, if I had kids, I'd stop complaining. We get kids. Well, if my kids would let me get some sleep, I'd stop complaining. If my kids were just in school. If I didn't have to drive my kids who are in school to every practice in the world, why do we have 17 practices in 17 different locations? I would be grateful if I didn't have to do that. If my kids weren't in college and I didn't have to pay $100,000 to get them a job so that they don't have to be a barista for the rest of their life, I would stop complaining. If my kids would just get married and find someone and settle down, I'd be so happy. If my kids would ever speak to me and my kids would come around and if I saw my kids, I would be happy. And instead of gratefulness leading to contentment, we believe that contentment points us to gratitude. God has it in reverse. If we are grateful, we will find contentment with what we have. So literally creating list of reasons I have to be grateful rather than list of what I don't have brings me contentment. Rajiv and I were talking about this. It's like as soon as you buy a vehicle, you see that vehicle that you want, and you're like, oh, man, I want that vehicle. And you buy it, and you're like, yeah, I'm happy. This is great. Thank you, God, for this vehicle. What's that vehicle over there? Wow, that one's bigger than mine. I told him, I said, as soon as I bought a Jeep Wrangler, I noticed every Jeep Rubicon. I'm like, well, what about the Rubicon? Where'd that, right? So what we do is we think, if I have something that makes me content, I will become grateful. God says, if you are grateful, you will become content. It is literally countercultural to everything that we are doing in our culture today. Give me something, and then I will say thank you. God says, say thank you for what you have, and I'll bless you with so much more than you could ever think, dream, or imagine. It brings us contentment. Next, it leads us to true joy. It leads us to true joy. I do not know the author who said this, but somebody said, one of the surest measures of spiritual maturity is what it takes to rob us of our spirit-given joy. He said, we often will think that spiritual maturity is like, well, I don't do this and I don't do this. But he said, real true spiritual maturity is, I have the joy of the Lord in my life and nothing can take it from me. See, the enemy doesn't attack us like he used to do the old school church where he used to like, let's throw people to lions. What he does is he just says, you know what, I'll figure out why you're happy and I'll take it away and then I'll watch you come unglued. So Job ends up sitting on a pile of ashes. His family, which made him happy, is gone. His money, which made him happy, is gone. His health, which made him happy, is gone. And he says, blessed be the name of the Lord. That's true spiritual maturity. Next, gratitude is a testimony of encountering the presence of God. This is why, man, listen, preaching to these teenagers, what they did is so cool. Instead of sitting in their chairs, they all came up to the stage that they had and worshiped, and there was kids kneeling down and praying. There was kids crying, and I'm preaching to these teenagers, and I'm encountering the presence of Lord as teenagers are pouring out gratitude to God loudly during worship. I'm thankful for this person, this person, this person. I'm thankful for this. It brings us into the presence of God. Psalms 105:1 says this, give thanks to the Lord and proclaim his greatness. Then listen to what it says. Let the whole world know what he has done. Well, I just don't raise my hand because I don't want to be embarrassed. We've got to let the whole world know what God has done for us. 1 Peter 3:15, in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. What Peter is saying is our argument for Christ is not like I'm superior in my knowledge to you. Our argument for Christ is, hey, during the middle of the pandemic when all the world is falling apart, I know that I have hope because I have Jesus. And he says, then do it gently. Don't be a jerk about it. Be respectful and kind, but point out, always point out, yes, we're having a hard time, but we have hope that it will get better. Somebody said this, gratitude in a world of discontent and complaining is one of the best testimonies of salvation in all of the world. In a world that complains literally about everything, gratitude reveals that you have been in the presence of God. So I went through my points fast. I have a story to tell you. I don't think I've ever told you this before. I can't remember because, hey, I can't remember sometimes if I'm in line at Starbucks or not. But I don't think I've ever told this story. And the reason I say this is because it's a hard story for me to tell because there's a lot to it in my childhood. And I sometimes am afraid of, like, telling a story that's too good to be true, right? Like, oh, yeah, you're making that up. But I can tell you that I asked my mom to word for word text me the entire story in case I was forgetting a part of it. And it is a story of just the miracles of God. So I'm going to tell you this story, but first of all, I want to point something out. Your phone, if you have a smartphone, does something called movie memories. Now, Rika is way cooler and smarter and better at technology than me because I didn't know that this existed. But my wife showed it to me and she's like, everyone knows this. And I'm like, not everyone. I didn't know you could email. And so what it does is your phone looks at your memories. It puts them together in a movie. It adds music and dramatic stuff and scenes. And it adds it and it sends it to you as a movie memory. So my wife showed it to me. She's like, hey, remember we went to Sedona, Arizona? Shout out, Sedona, Arizona. And she said, like, hey, look at this. And it showed this whole video of us, like, rafting. And there was this scorpion that tried to climb on my paddleboard in the middle of a canyon. So it met its creator because I wasn't ready to meet my creator yet. And it was, like, showed this whole video. And I'm like, this is amazing. She said, yeah, your phone does this. I said, no, mine doesn't. It doesn't do that. Like, click. Oh, there it is, right? Here's what happens in our life. You have movie memories written in your mind. They're in your mind. So here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you and tell you the secret to gratitude is to meditate on your miracles. Because here's what happens. We fill our mind with so many memories of the misery that we run out of storage space, so we send the miracles to the cloud and we never see them again. So I can ask you a question of when someone offended you and you can tell me what they were wearing in their car, what car they were driving, what limit, what model it was, where you were on the road, how their eyes were sticking out and their face was red and they had a middle finger, and you can give me the details down to the memory of the misery. And then I can ask you, tell me someone who's done something good for you recently or God's been good to you. Well, I'm married, so I guess that's cool. What happened? We focus on the misery so much that we run out of storage space for the miracles. So look, we need to work on meditating on the miracles. You have miracles happening around you daily, but you got to meditate on those. I'm going to tell you this story. I hesitated to tell it. I was like, I'm not going to do it, but I'm going to do it, all right? And so most of you know that I grew up in a family of pastors. Like, all of my siblings are pastors. My dad is a church planner. His church is like 52 or 56 years old. I'm trying to remember right now. It's like he started his church when he was 21. And after 8 years of pastoring his church, he had 4 kids. He had 10 members of that church that were in his family because there was us 6. And then there was my grandpa, my grandma, and my aunt. And after 8 years, there was 8 other people who had joined the church. So 8 years into planning a church, he has, on a really good day, 18 people. And he's working another job, cutting trees down. He's sawing trees for a living. He's doing that Monday through Friday and sometimes on Saturday. And he's coming in on Sunday exhausted, trying to figure out, how do I preach to people? How do I help people? And along the way, I had to go to the hospital for a month because I got some disease that made me sick, and I'm sitting in the hospital for a month. So those hospital bills are just racking up as they're doing all these blood transfusions for me. His house burns down. He has insurance on his house, but nothing in his house. So they lose everything. Then we all get swine flu, my entire family. It's like swine flu or Spanish flu, whichever one it was. We caught it, all of us. So for 6 weeks, we all lived in our living room and just were all sick. And along the way, my dad's sawing a tree, and he's bending down, sawing a tree, and then he wakes up on the ground with the saw beside him running because his hand is paralyzed, and he's holding the thing down, and he didn't realize that a tree had fallen on him, and it paralyzed him from the waist down. So here he is, 4 kids, hospital bills, 18 people in his church, hospital bills for me. It's December. So my dad starts doing something. He says, you know what, I think that since I can't saw trees anyways, I'm just going to go full time into church, and this is what I'm going to do with my life. So for 2 weeks, he has a photocopy of this picture in his office. For 2 weeks worth of about 60 hours a week, he got a check in the second week of December for $23.67. Now he's got a house to pay for, vehicles to pay for, hospital bills to pay for, and he's like, we're not having Christmas this year. It's just not happening. So we gather together when he gets this check, and literally my dad says, this is what we're going to do. We're all going to sit down, we're all going to pray, and we're all going to list things that we're grateful for. And mine was what is happening right now, the snow. So I'm like 4 or 5 years old. Thank you for snow. That night it turned up to like 60 degrees and all the snow melted. And then it froze again and there was no snow, but it was like 20 degrees. So we had no snow. We had no money. We run out of food. So literally on Christmas Eve, my parents shut all the curtains in the house so we don't have to look outside at the brown world that we live in. And they make us a meal to eat because Christmas Eve is going to be the meal that we're going to eat. And then on Christmas Day, we're just going to stay at the house and not have food. That's where we were as a family. Everyone in America always says, I grew up so poor. But legit, we grew up so poor. So we have nothing. We don't even have our health because we're all recovering from the flu. And my dad and my mom say to us, we're going to gather by the wood stove because we have wood heat. So we're going to make a list of things we're grateful for. And that includes the fact that we have heat because we can't keep the water running or the bills paid, but we'll always have heat. So we sit down and we begin to pray. This is the part where it's like too good to believe. We're praying and we hear a knock on our door. We get up and we walk out. There's a family that came from Florida. They've never really attended my dad's church, but they came from Florida. They had boxes and boxes and boxes of oranges for us. And they said to us, we're not really sure why, but we have a truckload, like a 53-foot truckload of oranges that we brought from Florida that we're selling, and we just felt like God told us to bring you guys some oranges. And then we were like, well, if we're going to bring them oranges, we might as well bring them food. So they brought in bags of food and boxes of oranges. I'm sure that I've eaten an orange before, but I never remember anything as good as that orange. I can remember being in the hallway watching this man bring in boxes of oranges and my mom peeling me one and handing me one and eating it and being like, this is the best thing I've ever eaten in my life. But something else happened. They were at the store buying us food, and they saw a family from our church and said, hey, we're going over to Pastor Williams' house, and we're going to bring him some stuff. And the lady said, you know what? I've been thinking about them, so I made them some Christmas gifts. Now, I think that I put these on here on Proclaim, but do you have a picture of the Christmas gifts that we got? It should be like some hats and mittens and gloves. Are they on there? That was my Christmas gift. She hand-sewed us a pair of gloves. And it was like Santa brought the entire world to me. My mom saved the gloves. I wore those gloves everywhere for months. I was so proud of those gloves. On Christmas Day, we ice skated around the lake. It was one of the coolest things. No snow, but clear ice. You could see fish below us, and we're ice skating around the lake, and my hands are actually warm. And I'm eating oranges, and I'm like, my life is so good. She made us some scarves, she made us some little hats, and she made us gloves, and we ate oranges, and it was like the best Christmas I ever had. And here's what happens in my life. Anytime I begin to be discontent, I eat an orange. Anytime in my life I start to get, you know what, no one knows how hard it is for me, I just eat an orange. And I meditate on the miracles that God has given me in my life. Instead of focusing on everything I think is wrong with the world, I just have this picture of a pair of mittens that my family sends to each other every year to remind ourselves, we have it so good. We have it so good. Paul said this, he said in Philippians 1:3, I thank my God upon every memory of you. Do you know that he wrote this to the people who had caused him to be thrown in jail and beaten? And he said, I thank my God on every memory of you. These were the people that he converted to Christianity, and then they got him in trouble and he got thrown in jail. And yet what Paul remembers out of the story is not the misery, he remembers the miracle. So we got to meditate on miracles to find gratitude. What in your life is a miracle? See, if I asked you, tell me 5 people who made you mad, tell me 5 people who upset you, tell me 5 things that have gone wrong, I'm willing to bet that myself included, all of us could remember the detail of the clothes they were wearing when they upset us or when things went wrong. But so often, if I were to say, tell me the best 5 things that ever happened here to you at Church in the Wild, we'd say, whoa, I think someone got saved one time, I don't remember. Tell me something about your family that you love. Well, my spouse works hard, so that's cool. Your spouse is a miracle. Your children are miracles. There was days when we had 3 miscarriages that we prayed daily for a baby. And there are days when all I can remember about my daughter is, man, I wish she'd just behave for once. And God says, why don't you meditate on the miracles? And you'll start being really grateful that God gave you that little Hurricane Isla. What Paul remembered was the miracles and not the misery. He remembered the chains breaking, not the chains being placed on him. He remembered the song that they sung in prison, not the words that the jailer said to him. He remembered the jailer being saved with his family. Paul rejoiced in prison, and he rejoiced at the memory of the prison doors breaking open because he meditated on the miracles God put in his life. We've got to learn to master our memory instead of letting our memories master us. Sometimes our memories control us. We can't think of anything besides the bad because we filled our memories on our minds. We filled those memory movies so full of space that the room for the miracles is up somewhere in the cloud, and who even knows what the cloud is? It's just bouncing around somewhere. If you remember all the times he delivered you, the Bible says that David said, I recall it to my mind that you delivered me. He called it to his mind. You know what he did? He mastered his memory. He meditated on his miracles. He literally said, I believe it's in Psalm 42 where he said, why am I so crestfallen? Why am I broken down? I will recall the times that God delivered me. He called it to his memory. He said, I will think about when God saved me. He mastered his memory. So what is your miracle? What's the miracle in your life? Maybe you didn't grow up like me, and maybe an orange isn't a big deal to you. But every Christmas Eve when an orange is in my stocking from my mom, it's like the greatest thing in the world because we sit down and just for a moment we remember the curtains drawn, hand-me-down clothes from my cousin, and a little pair of mittens, and eating some oranges. And all of a sudden, I'm really grateful for my truck, and I'm really grateful for all the presents that are sitting somewhere in our house, and we haven't done anything with them. So much so that we're like, let's take all these gifts to Stowe Mission and give them to people. When I meditate on miracles, I master my memory. Focus on the miracles. Choose to remember the miracle. Here's what you do when your spouse is just annoying you to death. Choose to remember that wedding day kiss. When your kids are driving you nuts, choose to remember the moment that you held your child for the first time in your arms and you just wept because you didn't know what else to do. Choose to remember the good God has done in your life. Meditate on miracles. So what we're doing today, we're going to close in worship today. And I get an orange for everyone here. When we leave, you're going to get an orange because I want you to take it and for a moment burn it into your mind and remember the miracle that God has given you. An orange is a miracle. So meditate on your miracles. What is God doing in your life? What has he done for you? He can cure so many things for you. He can bring you contentment and joy and peace and freedom with just a simple, you're too good to not believe. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you are good, kind, gracious, loving, just. You're holy, you're righteous. You are a miracle-working, wonder-working God. You are too good to not believe. God, I pray that we would meditate on the miracles and master our memory. We would recall your works of old to our mind. We would call them when the enemy attacks us and say, oh yeah, well, I remember when God did this. And I'm going to meditate on it until I remember every detail of the miracle, down to the color of the mittens that I was wearing. and the way the orange tasted when I bit into it on Christmas Eve. And help us to find gratitude, and through gratitude, help us to find joy and contentment. And we'll ask this in Jesus' name.